Hello friends, welcome to my channel. In this video, we are going to do the stock analysis of one of your favorite chemical stocks, which has been in the news in the recent times, and you have requested for that video on our Telegram channel, that is Tata Chemicals. Before we begin, if you are not subscribed to my channel, please do subscribe right now and consider joining our YouTube community, where we are discussing a lot of stock specific news views, daily market analysis, and lots of exciting things. You can follow me on Telegram and on Twitter as well. So let's get started. Tata Chemicals is an innovative, science-led, sustainable chemistry company. So if you see by their introduction, they have a lot of focus on innovation in the chemistry business. They are not a normal chemical company which just manufactures any other chemical, but they are continuously innovating, researching, and developing more and more products, more and more advanced products in their existing chemical business. They are also keeping in mind the sustainability of the environment. It's a global company, like any other company which has a base in India and exporting to different companies. Tata Chemicals is different as it has presence in a lot of other countries outside India as well. Present in the sense they have manufacturing units also outside India. It employs more than 4,600 people and it has presence in 40 plus countries across the globe. They have an existence of more than 8 decades, which shows that it's a very established company, which is owned by, of course, the very well-known Tata Group. They are into two types of chemicals. One is basic chemicals and the other is specialty chemicals. They have leadership in lot of products such as soda ash, bicarb, salt, conventional silica, marine chemicals, and in the nutraceutical business also now they are getting leadership in products such as FOS, GOS, and through their subsidiary Rallis, they have market leadership in certain agricultural related products also. The management of this company is led by Mr. R. Mukundan, who is the managing director and CEO. He's an engineer from IIT Roorkee. He's an MBA from FMS Delhi. He's an alumnus of Harvard Business School and he has joined Tata Group in the year 1990. In the Tata Group, he has worked in different industries such as chemical, hospitality, automotive sectors. Up till now, Tata Chemicals, till the year 2016-17, they were into the business of inorganic chemicals, fertilizers, and agricultural chemicals. In the year 2018, they have discontinued their business of urea and phosphate fertilizer. So in 2018, the only businesses which remained were inorganic chemicals. In 2019, it entered into specialty chemicals business also. And in 2020, they demerged the consumer products business, as we all know, into another company of their group, which is Tata Consumer Products. So this is the journey of this company so far. Now let's understand the business model. As we have discussed, there are two divisions, basic chemistry and specialty chemicals. In specialty chemicals, again, there are four segments. One is agri-sciences, which is related to the agricultural chemicals and fertilizers, which is through their subsidiary Rallis. Nutritional sciences, which is related to the nutraceutical products. Material sciences, which are related to performance materials. And energy sciences, which is a new division which this company has started working on, which is related to the EV theme, the electronic vehicles theme. Let's talk about the basic chemical products. In this, they are manufacturing soda ash, bicarb, salt, marine chemicals, crushed refined soda, and interestingly, cement also. The end users of these products are the other industries, so this is a B2B business. Tata Chemicals is the world's third largest producer of soda ash. It is India's leading edible vacuum salt manufacturer. Coming to the agri-sciences business, they are into seeds manufacturing, crop care, and active ingredients related to the agricultural chemicals. The end users of these products are farmers, so this is a B2C business, and they have a very strong distribution network which is able to reach almost 80% of the Indian districts. They are able to connect to almost 13.5 million farmers. So such is the strong connectivity network. They have leadership in products such as Hexa, Pendi, Asphate and Mercury. Coming to the nutritional sciences business, they are manufacturing ingredients and as well as formulation solutions for the human and animal health products. The end users of these products are both B2B and B2C, and they hold a lot of patents in this particular segment of products, which gives them an advantage over the competitors. It is India's first nutritional science company which is manufacturing FOS and GOS, and globally it is the second in short chain FOS production. Coming to the material sciences division, it's manufacturing alkali chemicals, performance silica and other nano materials. This may sound a little technical, but for us it is important to understand overall in which divisions the company is in and whether those divisions or segments are growing pretty well or not. The end users of this material sciences products are again the other industries, so it's a B2B business. They have patented technology for HDS, which is highly dispersible silica, which is used in tires, and they have strong R&D capabilities in the nanotechnology sector. Coming to the latest, which is the energy sciences, Tata Chemicals aspires to become a leader in this sector, the energy chemistry sector, and they aspire to gain 25% of the market share going further of the lithium ion battery. This is something which is very interesting to note, and there is a lot of scope of growth in this particular segment. There are not much competitors also in this segment, so this company will have a first mover advantage. In the energy sciences, which is related to the lithium ion battery, they want to manufacture the active materials which are involved in the cell manufacturing. They want to do the cell manufacturing. They want to also do the battery pack manufacturing, and they also plan to do, in fact, they have started doing the recycling of the lithium ion batteries. Let's see the segmental revenue. Majority of the revenue comes from basic chemicals as of now, which is almost 97.5%, and specialty chemicals is only 2.6%. If you see the product wise revenue, majority of the revenue comes from soda ash, which is about 51%, salt is about 28%, bicarb is 8.5%, and the rest of the products are 9.8% and around 10%. If you see the specialty chemicals, energy sciences has not started generating any revenue as of now. The performance material segment generates about 63%. So in the specialty segment, major chunk of revenue is coming from the performance materials. Nutritional sciences is about 14.9%. Agri sciences is about 21.6%. If you see by geography, major chunk of revenue is from Asia, which is 50%. America is 33%. Europe is 13%, and Africa is just about 4%. Now let's understand the market and the industry in which this company operates. It's different. I'll give you a small idea, a brief idea about all the segments in which this company manufactures the chemical products. If you see the soda ash market globally, it's kind of an oversupplied market, and hence the supply is more. That's why the prices are reducing, which is not a good thing for this company. Bicarb, which is another major product, the demand is steadily maintained, but the selling prices are falling. Salt, if you see, again the demand is steadily maintained, and since it is having an arrangement with Tata Consumer and supplying to Tata Consumer, there is not much risk in this segment, as it has a well-established brand, which is Tata Salt, and the demand is expected to be maintained steadily. So if you see now the basic chemicals, the news is not, or the growth is not that great. Cement, if you see, the demand is stable, but the prices are increasing, which is an advantage. The crop care business is growing well, which is through the subsidiary Rallis, but the crop care business is a little cyclical business, which is dependent on monsoon. If you see the nutritional science market, it is going pretty well, and there is a lot of scope in developing new and new products in this segment. The material sciences, which are performance related materials, that also has a wide use and great demand. And coming to the lithium ion battery, all of us know that it is an emerging sector, and there is tremendous scope once the EV vehicles become successful and widely accepted in the country. If you see the competitors of this company, GHCL, Bharat Rasayan, Coromandel International, Fine Organics, Madhu Silica Private Limited, and the other global players are some of the competitors of this company. Now, what is the competitive advantage or economic moat which Tata Chemical has when compared to its competitors? The first and the most prominent is the brand value. Anything which the Tata Group manufactures carries a lot of brand value and trust among the people across the globe. The management is in good hands, and the company has a lot of products in which it has market leadership and patents. It has well-established relationships with all the stakeholders, and operationally, they have efficiencies in production, so they are able to provide their products at the lowest cost across the country. Technology-wise, we have discussed that they are developing new and new products continuously. And in the energy sector and in nutritional science sector, they are manufacturing some products in which they are the first ones to make, so they have a first mover advantage. Growth prospects also, let us discuss segment wise. Coming to the basic chemistry, they are going for capacity expansion. They are going for debottlenecking at their plant, which is at Mithapur. There is one of the subsidiary of this group called Tata Chemical Soda Ash Partners Holdings, which is a US subsidiary, in which another group called Andover Group had some stake. They have bought the 25% stake of that group, and for which they have spent about 1387 crores. They are not restricting themselves to basic chemicals, and in this basic chemicals also they are trying to manufacture value added products. They are doing for forward integration and manufacturing end products of soda ash. They have planned a capacity expansion of bicarb, salt and soda ash of about 2400 crores in India. Coming to the growth prospects of the agri sciences business through its subsidiary Rallis, there are new products being developed continuously across different segments, which is crop protection, nutrition and seeds. They have succeeded in manufacturing new formulations technology, which is GM and non-GMO traits. Again, there is a capacity expansion planned in Rallis also, which is about 800 crores. And recently, there was a merger between Metahelix Life Sciences and Rallis. Coming to the nutritional science, the portfolio of this particular segment of products is continuously expanding. They are focusing to manufacture high-grade natural extracts of food and pharma sectors. And recently, they have started a new plant to manufacture nutraceuticals at Nellore. Coming to the material sciences, they have commissioned a 10 KTPA silica manufacturing plant at Cuddalore. There has been a capacity enhancement for manufacturing nano zinc oxide. They are focusing on scaling the performance related products like silica and nano materials. In Europe also, they have been plans to invest about 18 million GBPs for expansion, and they are focusing on the HTS product where they have a patented technology, and they plan to expand in the other nano materials. Coming to the energy sciences, which is very interesting to know, they are planning to build technologies for manufacturing lithium-ion batteries and cells, and they have an MOU with a research institute for this. They plan to scale their battery recycling business, which they have already started, and they have already started partnering with leading battery manufacturers of India, research and development labs, and they plan a capacity 10 gigawatts per annum. They have partnered with their group company, which is Tata Technologies, to establish their own battery engineering unit in Pune. They are in talks with telecom companies for energy storage solutions also. They plan to build 1 gigawatt cell line by 2021 with technologies from a global partner. And they also plan to complete 2 to 3 commercial scale energy storage products. What could be the risks which Tata Chemicals may face? They may face a risk of digitalization, where they have to continuously adopt new and new technologies, else they'll become obsolete. IT risk is a risk for any company. They have market leading position in different products, so there is a risk that they may lose the leadership. They have to face risks of regulatory changes across the globe, and they have a lot of expansion plans, as we have discussed. So failure to achieve those particular targets or plans could be a risk. And due to the heavy capex which is being planned, there could be a liquidity risk. Now, after understanding the business aspects, let's go for the financials. Starting with the Q2 FY21 results, the revenue was down about 6% to 2609 crores. EBITDA was 386 crores, which was down 31% year on year. EBITDA margin was 15%. PAT was about 132 crores, which was down about 65%. Margin of profit was about 5%. So if you see on quarter on quarter, year on year, the quarterly result has not been that great. This, in terms of volumes, if you see, the soda ash volume has gone down to 744 KTS. IVSD salt has gone up to 295 KTS. The reason for this decline was mainly due to lower sales volumes and also higher cost of production. But quarter on quarter compared to the June quarter, there has been improvement. If you see the revenue trend, from financial year 16 to 17, there was a fall. After that, it has been maintained without much growth and it has reported about 10,356 crores in financial year 20. The net profit again has not been that great. It reported a profit of about 1510 crores in financial year 18, from which it has fallen down to 1032 crores in financial year 20. There was an exceptional gain of about 6,220 crores in financial year 2020 because of the restructuring of the company. The debt equity ratio gives a positive sign as it has been declining. On a standalone basis, this company is debt free. ROCE is kind of moving between 7 to 9%, which is not that impressive. The shareholding pattern, if you see, the promoters hold about 35.5%, FII is 9.1%, DII 29.2%, and others 26.3%. There's no pledge. The promoters' holding is steadily increasing, which is a good sign. The equity is consistently maintained, reserves are growing, debt is about 6,800 crores, debt equity ratio is about 0.5, which is pretty decent. There's cash of about 3,000 crores in the company, and that's why the net debt is around 3,700 crores. On standalone basis, it is debt free. Remuneration to whole-time directors is about 10 crores, which is well within the limits. And the stat auditors of this company are BSRN Company LLP, which is one of the big four firms. Free cash flow is about 580 crores in financial year 20. ROCE is 7.7, which is not very impressive. EBITDA is about 21.82%, which is pretty decent. Profit before tax is about 12%. June 2020, they have declared a dividend of about 110% on a face value of 10 rupees. Dividend yield is 2.2, which is pretty decent. Inventory turnover ratio is 5.4. Coming to the valuations part, the last traded price is about 500. 52-week high and low is 197 to 527, as recently it has given a very big rally. The last 1 year, the return is about 72%, and 5 years is about 196%. The market cap has now become 12,700 crores, so it's a mid-cap company. In quarter two of FY21, the EPS was about 2.77. If I take this EPS four times, it comes to about 11 rupees. Taking this approximate as an EPS, if we see the PE, it comes to about 45. We are not taking the recent year's EPS because there has been an exceptional item. So for the latest quarter result available, we are trying to estimate the PE, which comes to about 45. Industry PE for generally chemicals is about 20-25. The book value is about 536. So in terms of book value, the valuation looks pretty reasonable as it is less than the book value. If you see the price chart, there has been a sharp rally recently, and that's why the first support could be somewhere around the 50 EMA, which is about 433 rupees. So for somebody who wants to get into the stock and add it to their portfolio, the starting point of investment in installments could be the 50 EMA mark, which is around 433 rupees. Coming to the recent news and announcements, the soda ash demand, as we have discussed, had fallen recently, but is almost getting back to normal now. Rallis, their subsidiary, is running at full capacity, and overall the company has planned about 3,500 crore expansion. The managing director in one of the interviews has told that the specialty chemicals business may grow 5 times in the next 10 years. So this is about Tata Chemicals. To summarize, it's a strong promoter-driven company, as we know, and the market, the leadership team is also great. The company is well diversified into different segments, which gives a lot of stability to the company. The opportunities are emerging in the nutraceuticals and energy sciences business, which are huge. They have good expansion plans. Liquidity position of this company is stable. The Tata Group is restructuring different companies in their group, and they are having some great growth plans. The sector is good, and that company will experience a lot of tailwinds going further. But the basic chemical business is slow growing. They could face competition with other players in the same industry. In terms of valuation, the stock is a little expensive, and that's why we should enter at reasonable valuations, as we have discussed in the earlier slides. So thank you for watching this video. I hope you like it. Please do consider joining the YouTube community and subscribe to the channel. Leave your feedback in the comments whether you like this video or not, and follow me on Telegram. Don't forget to leave in the comment the name of the company about which you want me to make the next video. Thank you for watching and have a wonderful day.